Now we have to look back upon ourselves and try to find out what have we achieved out of this. We must understand that Sahaja Yoga is not done through brain activities. Like many people think that if you just tell yourself you have to be like this, it will work. If you have to all the time inform yourself that, oh, you must get rid of a particular problem, it will be alright. Or some people think that if they tell somebody that this is wrong with you and you should get well, it will be alright. It is not so. Because Sahaja Yoga does not work on mental level. It works on spiritual level, which is a much higher level than the mental level. So what you have to do is to understand how to correct your chakras. And you must understand how to work out your machines. Perhaps people still live on mental level and try to solve problems on mental level. And that's why all the problems start coming up. Now, if you have a problem with any chakras, or there is anything catching, or you find that there's something wrong, no use working it out on any other level but spiritual level. Some people believe that if they have dressed up like something, or if they outwardly behave like something, they become that. That is not. Like we have hippies in the West, and they think that they have become primitive. You do not become primitive by hippies. Because you are so overdeveloped that you cannot become primitive. So by just doing something mentally, we do not become. Now this mental level can go even further in a subtler way. Some of you might feel that by knowing some of the artis and things by heart, you will achieve great, is not true also, because that is also just words. But if that is an awakened thing within you, then they become a mantra. And then you can work it out. But first of all, you must achieve a certain standard to have that power to create the mantras. Also, when you say samarthi, it's not necessarily possible that it will work out. Let us face the things as they are and not to be conditioned by anything else. You have to achieve a certain depth within yourself to even enlighten the mantras. First of all, you should have clear-cut vibrations, minimum of minimum. If you have certain chakras catching, then try to improve your chakras with the photograph, with all due respect to the photograph. It's only the photograph which is going to work it out, nothing else. Or if I am there. But once you have achieved a certain state of enlightenment, then you can use mantras, otherwise also it will help. But first of all, your heart must be clear. I have found out in general, there are two chakras overwhelmingly not working all right in most of the Western people. First is the heart. That means heart is not clear. That heart is not clean. That in the heart you still are a small person. In the heart you have not placed your mother. You have to purify your heart by looking at the photograph and putting all loving feelings about your mother, understanding her work and putting her into your heart. If the heart is not clear, then everything has no meaning, because it is a dark heart which is doing all these things. The heart has to be clean, absolutely surrendered, and must try to put me before everything else. I can tell you because we are all surgeries. I cannot say this to people who are not surgeries. Now, we always try to relate Sahaja Yoga from our own terms, not from the terms that belong to God. God is what He is. He cannot change Himself. You have to change. So, whatever we think about God, we want to put on that. For example, if someone thinks that he tries to be nice or good to me, or if he is close to me, so-called, and if he thinks he is organizing better or he is doing this work or that work, or anything else like that, where he feels that he is important because he is doing this job or that job, then one must know that all this is mental. Actually, you are doing nothing. Whenever you try to do something, you really confuse yourself and confuse me also. We have seen yesterday's example. I was sure that they had to go next day. But nobody would listen to me and they rushed away and they found that the tickets were for the next day. This knowledge comes to you if you are clear-hearted. As yesterday I said, you better not come. I didn't know what was the situation there. I just said, don't come, finished, because I knew what was going to happen. So this clear-cut idea comes to you when your heart is clean. But first of all, people do not understand that you have to work it through your heart and not through your brain. When we have to work out things through our brain, we try to develop our brain. Isn't it? By memorizing, by practicing something, teaching our brain how to think, how to go this way, that way, we try to train our brain. Now we have to train our heart in Sahaja Yoga. And to train our heart in Sahaja Yoga, one has to know first of all that it is enveloped either by ego or by supreme. The limbic area actually represents the heart. And if there is ego, heart will always be so-called. It will not be the real heart that will be working, but it's only mental projection. And you will feel that I'm doing it from my heart. Must not. Now then, supposing what should we do if we have ego? You might say you should try to sort of tell yourself that that's not good and this and that and all kinds of mental suggestions. Or auto-suggestions, or this, the way psychiatrists know that give you suggestions. That's again mental. So that's not the way it is going to work out. We must understand that for that, what we have to do is to raise the left side and put it to the right side. There's no other way. You have to just work it out with your hands. Your hands are working it out, and not your brain. So use your hands and the methods of Sahaja Yoga. Now, everyone must have a regular sitting in the water every day. That's important. Every morning you must do your meditation. Because on mental level we feel we have been with mother, all right. This exposure is all right. You came, you saw how Indians are and how they are light on their feet and how they are good for surgery. But after seeing all that, you have to know that Sahaja Yoga is to be worked out, is not to be thought out. You just cannot think about it. Whatever you may try to do through your thought, you cannot achieve any results in Sahaja Yoga. You have to use your hands, you have to use your feet, you have to soak your feet in the water because water is the ocean. All these five chakras, or say six chakras, which are, I say five, because the one is the Muladhara chakra, which is the seventh, and the topmost is the brain. So in between five chakras, which are there, are to be handled fully with the idea that they are basically made of matter. And these five elements, constitute the body of these chakras. Now these chakras, if they are to be corrected, we have to correct them by taking out all the problems of these chakras into the elements from which they come. For example, a person who is a very right-sided person, so he has to give up balance by the left side. Of course, raising the hand is all right, but what about the element? Right-sided person has all the elements which give heat. We can say the light, we can say the fire. So for people who are right-sided, the light is not going to help much. Like if you put the light before the photograph, and those who are ego-oriented people, if you just use the light, it's not going to work out. So what is going to work out is the Mother Earth and the water element, which is cooling. Even ice is very helpful to people who are right-sided. So all cooling effects should be used for correcting your right-sidedness, so that you cool it down. Same about food. In food, those who are right-sided people should take to foods which are left-sided, that is carbohydrates, means they should become partly vegetarians or quite a lot of vegetarians. And should eat things at the most like chicken, but not fishes, not seafoods, because they are all hot. That's how you treat your material side of your chakras. Now the left-sided people should use again the deepa, means the light or the fire, to correct their left side. Also in food, such people should take more to nitrogenous, means protein, and foods like that. They should take more proteins. Now as far as Sahajyoga is concerned, the basic thing is Kundalini. And the Kundalini, as I have told you, is the pure desire. Again, listen to it carefully, pure desire. That means all other desires are impure. There's only one pure desire, and that is to be one with the Divine, one with the Brahma, one with God. That's the only pure desire. All other desires are impure. So train your mind gradually to achieve that desire as the main thing. If you train your mind in that fashion, then you can develop pure desire. So all other desires will negate gradually. All right. Now this desire to be one with the Divine is the purest and the highest. And to achieve that, what have you to do? To achieve that, you have to keep your mother pleased. Very simple. Adi Shankaracharya has said that you don't bother about it, just keep your mother pleased. You have to be a simple person. Not try to be cunning with me or clever with me. I know everyone very well. Try to tell yourself that I should say things, I should behave in a manner that will please my mother. Supposing you are in Sahajyoga and you are doing wrong things, it is not going to please me at all. So how to please mother, that you should try to see for yourself. What kind of a thing pleases me? I am also a very simple person. So I want a simple-hearted person. Who is simple-hearted? For example, a person who tries to show off too much, try to be always the first, or try to be always the sort of a cinema star. I don't like such people. You have to be very quiet and extremely shy about showing off yourself. Do I show off that I am Adishakti? I do not. I live like you, absolutely like you. Do I try to show off? Then why should you try to show off to me? So that kind of a person is no good. Secondly, you should not be tense with me. There is no need to be tense. If I find something wrong with you, if I scold you also, it is for your good. If I say a good word, it is for your good. My Sahaja Yoga works this way. I have no malice against anyone in the whole world, no malice at all. And no anger for anyone in this world. I have nothing but compassion. But in compassion, sometimes I have to scold, and in the same compassion, I have to speak in a very compassionate manner. So, both ways, it helps you. It helps you both ways. So, thank God that you have somebody who will correct you at the right time for your good, because you are saints. And you have come on this earth to establish God's kingdom. That's what you have to do. And if you are the people who are not respected, who are not sensible, who haven't got the dignity, who behave in a cheapish way, how can people accept it? So this heart chakra is to be first looked after. That with your heart, desire that you will keep your mother pleased. Even if I am angry with you, don't feel bad about it. That's one of the signs that Sahaja Yoga has not entered. If I scold you, it is because there is something in you which has to go away and which I must scold, so it will go. So accept it just as a correcting point that is good for you. Some sort of a thorn is within you which has to be taken out by another thorn, and mother has taken it. Once you start understanding the compassion of your mother, you will not mind. My saying anything to you, my correcting you, or my telling you that this is wrong, because I have to do that. Those people who do not have a good heart, clean heart, cannot understand this. They cannot understand this. Very difficult. So you keep your heart clean towards your mother. Whatever I do for you is just a blessing, always a blessing for you. Whatever I do for you is a blessing, remember that. Now another chakra which is horribly caught up with most of you is your Nabhi chakra, suggesting that you are still very, very materialistic. In small, small things also we are materialistic. It becomes subtler and subtler and subtler. So try to understand that matter is not so important. Matter is just there to please each other, especially to please your mother. It has no other value whatsoever. So you should not try to be materialistic in the sense that, you see, for a little thing you have to do this, for a little thing you have to do that. Nothing is important. If it works out, well and good, and if it doesn't work out, well and good. So, you see, Nabhi chakra is very individualistic, very individualistic. It is everybody's personal thing. If your desire is only up to Lakshmi Pound, point, that you want to have more money or you care for little things here and there, without any spiritual value to it, then your Lakshmi Tattva at the most might be awakened. But this Lakshmi Tattva has to become Mahalakshmi Tattva. That is for your ascent. And just to get it to that Mahalakshmi Tattva, what you have to do is to use all your material things and your material being in such a way that you please me. That is very important. So you should not do something that will not please. That's very important. Everybody must understand. I want you to understand that when you dress up, also certain things I don't like at all, like disheveled hair at all. That might be a fashion, whatever do, but I don't like it. Always must be properly combed, properly done hair. These modern things you should give. Of disheveled hair, because this is a sign of pakka bhoots coming in. If you have disheveled hair, the bhoots recognize a person and they get into such a person who has disheveled hair. So try to make your hair in a proper, see now Indians how they make their hair. Look at them, they all make their hair properly. because I have nothing to do with your hair. I am not a hair styling person or anything. But if you do not have your hair properly combed and done, then definitely you are in for trouble. So take heed to these things. Then some people have a habit of being untidily dressed. That's also not a good thing. You have to be tidily dressed, clean and tidily dressed. Not because it is material, but it is very important that if it is not so, that kind of a material will attract all the badhas into it. You must keep yourself clean and neat because these badhas should not enter. All these ideas that have come to the West have come from some satanic force. It doesn't look beautiful in any way, it doesn't look good for any spiritual force. We have to change our styles that will be appealing to the divine and not to the bhuts. We don't want any bhuts to come on us. If you understand this simple fact, then you will start dressing up in a way that may not be modern, may not be ancient, whatever it is neat, clean, spick and span. Otherwise, also if you see to the matter point more and more, though you are accumulating 1001 things which are plastic in temperament and nature, you should have few things which have a spiritual value. Not all extraordinary things that we try to have, because they have no spiritual value. So try not to accumulate all these nonsensical things to you. Gradually you will find you will reduce, you will go on reducing. You will have simpler lives, better things and spiritual things. Whatever you buy, see the vibrations and then buy, otherwise just don't buy. Because all kinds of nonsensical bhuts will be in your house and you will be in trouble. So whatever you want to buy, you must see on vibratory awareness. If you cannot understand, ask somebody else, a Sahajogi, to help you. But don't go on buying things just because you think they are cheap or they are nice or good. So try to buy things which are vibration-wise are all right. And if it is not so, finish it. It's nothing important. I must buy this, I have to go to Bombay to buy this. That's a wrong idea. Now attention has to be inward all the time. I have seen that our attention is outward. Because of that, what we see outside is not good for vibrations. But if your attention is inside, you will not buy anything that is not good for vibration. Or you will not own something, you will just throw away. But the attention is outside, and because of that you just don't know how to judge it. Navi chakra has to be attended. For that, you don't have to think, you have to work it out, see which side of nabi is catching. If the right side is catching, for you, sugar is the best. Sugar represents many things. Sugar means your also tongue should be sweet, you should talk sweetly. People think that if you talk sweetly to someone, then people will start thinking that you are good for nothing, or you are absolutely a meek person. You have to be meek. We have to be meek and humble. We must learn how to talk sweetly to each other. And if you do not understand how to speak, then take more sugar, vibrated sugar. That will make your tongue sweeter and sweeter. And your ideas will be sweeter about another person than harsh and criticizing. So for the right-sided people, sugar is suggested. For the left-sided people, salt. Left-sided people should take salt more, and with salt they can solve many problems, because salt gives them a personality, a composer by which they can express themselves in a way which is dignified, also not very lethargic. So the speed of your talks or behavior or everything should be in the center. It should not be lethargic, nor should be too quick and fast and hectic. So you will understand Sahaja Yoga is the central point of everything. Everything in the center one should try to bring. Not one extreme to another extreme. If you talk too much and jabber too much and if you are fast, try to reduce your speed by alertly looking at it. You have to be alert. See, my speed is going down. There's no need for me to talk. Let me stop. But those who do not talk at all are also not good. So those who talk or those who do not talk have to understand only one thing, that whatever we talk in the center. Once you understand that, your responses to things will be absolutely central, balanced and beautiful. Now this is all for me, I can say at this time, because the time is short also for us. We have all enjoyed our stay all over. I think so, you all have been happy all over. And we have worked it out very well. And it has been quite a lesson to all of us and also a very great experience of enjoyment. So not to feel guilty about anything, because feeling guilty you do not get over it. Feeling guilty is an escape. You must face it. You must face it and see, correct yourself and be one. That is a much better way than to just to go on feeling guilty or aggressive. That's not the way, because as I said, it's not mental. So if you understand these few points on these two chakras, is nabhi and your heart. If you understand these two points clearly, that you must keep it clear. And the expression of that will show in your behavior, in your dress, in your walk, gait, talking and everything outside. But you cannot go from outside inside. Supposing somebody says that already, Mother, I have combed my hair very well, so I am alright. It's not so. Not necessary. Even if you have combed your hair, you might be possessed by a bhoot. But at least there's less chances. So one has to understand it, that it has to be worked out. I think this must be really screwed into your head, that Sahaja Yoga is to be worked out. You cannot just tell yourself, oh, I am very happy because it pampers your ego, or very unhappy because it is troubling through your super ego. I am very happy or I am very unhappy. That's not the way. You have to be in joy. And these things can work out. You should have patience with yourself, love for yourself and dignity. That you are Sahaja Yogis. Every individual has to work it out for himself, so the whole can be all right. There could be some people who are only worried about others. Worry about yourself and see the good points of others. Not the bad points, but good points of others. And also, if somebody has to tell you that you must organize, go fast and all that, not to feel bad. We have to be like that. We have to be very quick. We have to do so much work in this world. We have no time to waste. We have no time to waste. Has to be very quick, and we have to be very prompt and healthy about it. As you know that in this trip you have seen that how much work I have been doing compared to you. And I am so much older compared to you. Alright, you can say that Mother, your Adi Shakti is all. But I am your ideal. In any case, if somebody is your ideal, try to become like that person. Try to imbibe those qualities. You see how Rahul Bhai has love for me. And in this place, you all also got new ideas of creating a beautiful thing. And as love will increase, your creativity will develop. So the basis of all creativity of Saraswati is love. If there is no love, there is no creativity. It's even in the deeper sense, you see, people who have created all the scientific things are also out of love for the masses, not for themselves. Nobody has produced anything for themselves. If they make something for themselves, it has to be strong for universal use, otherwise it has no meaning. Even if you say atom bomb and all these things are created from science, they are also very protective. If they had not created those, people would not have taken out their minds from war. Now nobody can think of having a big war. Of course, they are having its own wars, but that also will gradually stop when they will be fed up of it. So all the activity on the right hand side of Saraswati basically has to end up in love, starts with love and ends up in love. Whichever does not end up in love coils up and finishes. It just disappears. So you can see that even matter which is not used for love just finishes. The basis has to be love. Otherwise, all such matter that we create, which has angularity, which is not fitting into the mass media, which is not appealing to the masses, of course, it takes time. You have seen that it takes time. But it does have that tendency always disappear in the thin air as soon as you find it does not appeal to the masses. Now this love of that we talk of, this great love of God we talk of, we know that it for definite through vibrations. People do not have vibrations, but still we can feel the vibrations in a very unconscious way. All the great paintings of the world have vibrations. All the great creative works of the world have vibrations. Only those who have vibrations have been sustained by time. Otherwise, all other things are destroyed. There must have been monuments and horrible statues and horrible things that have been created long time back, but were all destroyed by nature and they could not stand the impact of the Kala, that is, the destructive power of time. So all that is sustaining, all that is nurturing, all that is ennobling comes from this sense of love which is within us, very much developed, but within others also who are not yet realized. Ultimately the whole world has to realize that one has to go to that ultimate love of God, otherwise it has no meaning. Now you have seen in art people have taken to other methods of appealing to people by using cheap things and very vulgar things just to make people think that this is art. But this will all disappear. It cannot sustain the impact of the time, as I told you. It cannot, because the time will kill it. All these things have to disappear. And already you can see the result, how things are changing everywhere, even in the West. So there is no need to be so much disappointed with the West and to say that the Western world is a wasteland. It is going to be all right and it has to be done. Especially it has done a lot of puja of Saraswati, I should say, in the West. Much more than they have done in India, because they have gone to learning, they have tried to find out so many things. But only thing they forgot, that it is a goddess, goddess of learning. Everything comes from the goddess, that's what they forgot. And that's why all the problems have been created. If there is no spirit in your learning, if there is no source of the goddess in your learning, then it is absolutely useless. If they have realized that there is the spirit that is working it out, they would not have gone that far. And that's what I was warning the Indians all through, that you are now taking to industrial revolution in a way. And to avoid all the complications of industrial revolution, you must try to know the spirit. If you do not know the spirit, you will have the same problems as these people have, because they are also human beings, you are also human beings. You will go the same way, at random you will run, and there will be problems, the same problems as the Western people have suffered. Now, Saraswati's blessings are so many that one cannot describe in such a short time. And the Surya has given us so many powers that it is impossible to tell them even in one lecture, even in 10 lectures. But how we go against Surya and how we go against La Saraswati while doing the worship of Saraswati is to be seen very clearly within ourselves. For example, the Western people are very fond of Surya because they have no Surya. But they go too far with it, as you know, and create complications within themselves of Surya. But the main thing that one has to achieve through Surya is the light within, is the light within. And if Surya Chakra at the Agya level is occupied by Lord Jesus Christ, then it is even more essential that the purity of life, what we call niti, is the morality of life. the morality itself has become very much sort of an argument in the West. People don't have any sense of absolute morality. On vibrations, of course, you know. But they have gone all against it. Those who are the worshippers of Jesus, those who are the worshippers of the Surya, of the Saraswati, have all gone against. Against the powers of Surya. Just disobeying. Because you cannot be a Surya if you do not have a proper sense of morality and holiness. The Surya itself brings light. You see everything. So many qualities Surya has got. It dries up everything that is wet, dirty, filthy. It dries up all these places which create parasites. But so many parasites are created in the West. Not only parasites, but there are horrible cuts and horrible things which have come into that those countries which is supposed to be full of light. And in that darkness they exist. Darkness about their spirit, darkness about their own knowledge, and darkness about love. These three things have taken over in the places where you are supposed to love light. Light doesn't mean what you see with your gross eyes. Light means from within, the light of love. That one should understand. Light of love. And it's so soothing, it's so sweet, it's so beautiful, it's so enamoring, it's so abounding that unless and until you can feel that light within you, that light which is of pure, of purity, pure relationships, pure understanding, if you can develop that kind of a light within yourself, the whole thing will be cleansed. Wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. This is what happens to you when you are completely cleansed. The purest form of nature is within us. The purest form of nature is within us. Our chakras are made out of that purest form of nature. We are the only people who are spoiling it by our mental thinking. Again, the same Saraswati's work. We are going against Saraswati itself. Saraswati cleanses all that is impure in nature, while with our brain activity we are spoiling all that. All our brain activity goes against pure intelligence. And that's what one has to understand, that this pure intelligence is not to be soiled by our thinking. Our thinking can make us so bumptious, so ego-oriented, so impure, that we can really eat the poison and say, what's wrong? Just the opposite of Saraswati. If Saraswati vidina is within us, he gives us subuddhi, wisdom. And that's why to worship Saraswati, to worship Surya, we must have that clear vision as to what we have to be, what we are doing, what filth we are living in, what our mind is getting into. After all, we are here for emancipation and not for just pampering our ego and living with our filth that is with us. So this light should come within us and we should try to rise above our own mental filth which is being created around us. Apart from that, you have to go higher and understand that there is within us a thing called ego. And this ego is false, absolute false. You do not do anything. Actually, when you turn your eyes here and there, when your attention is here and there, it's nothing but your ego is trying to overpower you. But actually, ego is an absolute false. Because there's only one ego, and that is of God Almighty. Mahat Ahankara. There is no really any ego that exists. It's a myth. It's a very big myth. Because if you start thinking, you are doing everything, you are doing this, you are doing that, which you are not doing, then this nonsensical ego comes in and you start working it out. It can project in every direction. When it projects forward, it overpowers others. He tries to dominate others, tries to kill others, becomes cruel. When it moves right side, it becomes supraconscious. It starts seeing things which are absurd, which are foolish, which are stupid. When it moves left side, then it starts talking, seeing things, yourself as a big man, as a big Christ, or as a big Devi, or something. There are Adi Gurus and very great personalities. That's left side. When it moves backwards, that's the dangerous one. When people become Gurus, which are ruining other people. So when the ego moves backwards, then they become Gurus. They themselves have lots of defects in themselves, and they try to pull people into those horrible stuff, which is described as absolute Narka. That's how is the movement of ego on all the sides. Now, when people try to use their right Vishuddhi, that is to talk about themselves, is the worst of all. Whatever type of ego you may have, if you start boasting about it and talking about it, then it encircles, thickens the walls of ego so much that it is impossible to penetrate into that, because that such a person is completely satisfied with himself and he believes that he is true. And once he starts believing into a nonsense like that, it is an impossibility to penetrate. So when you boast about these things or you talk big, be careful. You see, you know what I am, but how many times do I say I am done? Even if I say once, it makes tremendous vibrations for me. But how many times do I say so? At the most, if you say something, I say, yes, but I don't say that. If I say it loudly, I don't know what may happen, the whole thing might be blasted with me. So one has to understand that Mahat Ahankara is the one that acts, that works, that really. Sometimes I shout at you, immediately all the books run out. Just once I shout, yesterday you saw all the books that were coughing, they all ran. Yesterday just I stopped. So you should understand that now, as you realize souls, you can also do the soul. Use your right Vishuddhi to shout at yourself. Now will you please stop boasting? Will you stop talking all this nonsense? Will you stop showing off? Then it will stop. Now this thickening takes place by people who really are active, who want to do something about it. Not that they are not active, they want to do it. But they know only one way is to act, talk. They don't understand that there are inner ways by which you control it much more. Because they don't want to take to that, they take to this talking. And once they take to talking and they talk about it, the whole power flows. But if they do not talk about it and keep it within themselves, it's all right, you can tell me about your experiences or anything. But if you start telling others and talking about it too much, then the powers that you have got will be all disappearing gradually. And you will just come down to absolutely lowest level. So one should not too much talk that I have this power, or I see this, or I do this, which is a very wrong thing. I warn you, don't try to show off. You can talk about my powers, it's all right. But don't try to talk about your powers. When it comes, of course, to talk to somebody who is a negative person, or to tell somebody, then you should say that we, not I, we have, some of us have felt this power within us. We have seen people. It may be you only, but you need not say I have. What you have to say, we. Then you become the Mahat Ahankara. When you say we, yes, some of us, we do. Like in Gregor's book also, I saw to it that he should not have many I's, but he should have we. We think, we do, we. Means the whole collective being, the whole collective organism, living organism of Sahajyogi. So you should say, yes, some of us have got. That means you put yourself down, but put all others above you. Say, yes, some of us have, I know some people have this. That's the way one should do it. Because if you have to overpower your ego, you must allow it to spread into everybody else. That's how you will make it perfectly all right. Make it spread. We all Sahajyogis. We all. But that pride is not there. I've seen that pride is not there. Still it is very individualistic. If you start thinking, we Sahajyogis, then what happens? That you become one person, one organization. But the person will look down upon other people. will see that this person is low, that person is high, that person is there. But he will not think, we, the surgeons, how beautiful we are. We, the body of surgeons, how beautiful we are. So always think in the words of we. So your ego will become much less, much less, much less. And the same ego, which looks so funny and absurd, will form tomorrow the Ekadashi. Today's individual ego will merge into Ekadashi. But we all must remember to say we all the time. This is what is today's day, is great day for us to change, because the sun has changed this moon now. Sun is coming this side. So let us welcome the sun coming to the north now, this way. And for Australians to say that though the sun has gone, let us establish the sun, the domain of sun within us. Because sun never disappears from our inside. So that is how we have to take a mood by which we should think of one personality, all of us together. All of us together. And anybody tries to be something separate or different, he'll drop off. I'll drop him off. Whatever it is, it will drop off. So you just don't know. Anybody who tries to be singled out or anything, everybody must do whatever they like to nurture the whole, to help the whole, to emancipate the whole, but not to in any way put anyone down or less. Because this is not the way the Sahaja Yoga is. Sahaja Yoga only works in collectivity. And the one who has developed this permeating spirit is a real Sahaja Yoga. Who has not is not. Whatever you may think of yourself, I have nothing to say. But this permeating personality, which moves from places to places, whether you talk or not, like your mother is, whether I meet you or not makes no difference, but I am permeating through all of you, by little, little things also, I am there with you. So like that, try to permeate into each other and see the beauty, and you'll enjoy yourself the best, because that is the biggest thing. That's the biggest thing that is to be achieved. Because this ego, you know, makes you like a nutshell, and you just cannot have a rapport with that beauty of permeation. And just see how the notes move into each other. It will be a great idea today. It's a great thing today we have to have puja dhulya. Like the dhulya means the dust, dust. And one day, I've written in childhood a poem, I remember. An interesting poem it was. I don't know where it's from, but we said that I want to be like flower, like a dust particle, which moves with the wind. It goes everywhere, can go sit on the head of a king, or can go and fall at the feet of someone. It can go and sit on a little flower, and it can go and sit everywhere. But I want to be a particle of dust that is fragrant, that is nourishing, that is enlightening. Like that, I had written a very beautiful poem where I must have been about 7 years of age, I remember, to be a dust particle. I remember that very clearly, long time back, that I should be a dust particle, so that I will permeate into people. Which is a very big thing, to become a dust particle of that kind. To that whatever you touch, you see, that becomes a living. Whatever you just feel, that has fragrance. It's such a great thing to be like that. And that was my desire, and it has been achieved. At that young age, I had this idea of becoming a dust particle. And today, just while talking to you, I remembered that I wanted to be that, and that is what is this place is. And Rauvia is like that. She's a very simple woman, very simple woman. And she lives like a very simple person, but she has a sense of permeation. And now there are so many Sahaja Yogis just educated. I'm sure they'll take it up, Sahaja Yoga, very well. There are lots of Sahaja Yogis from Dhulya now. And I'm sure there are going to be more people. I hope you have met all of them. Make friends with all of them. Try to know them, who they are. They may not know English, so get somebody to translate. Talk to them and be nice to them. Be friendly with them. I want you to meet them for permission. You should know who are the people here, who are in Nasi. Because somehow we never meet the Sahaja Yogis, you see, who are in that particular place. And when we go back, we have only one or two addresses. It's not a good idea. Try to see how many people there are. Ask about their questions. There are questions about them and all that. This permeation is only possible when your ego starts permeating all around. This is the way to overcome the problems of the right side, and that is how to worship Saraswati. Because Saraswati has a veena in her hand, and that veena is the primordial instrument which she plays, like music. And the music penetrates into the heart. You don't know how it goes into you and how it works out. And that's how a person who is a sojogi should permeate like music into everything. She has so many qualities, as I told you, which cannot be described in one lecture. But one of the greatest qualities of hers is that she ends up into subtler things, like the mother will end up into fragrance. Music will enter into melodies. Like that, whatever she creates ends up into something later. Matter, whatever she produces, ends up into aesthetics. If matter does not have aesthetics, then it is gross. Like that, everything. Now, you will say, what is water? Water becomes the river Ganges. These are the subtle. So, the matter gets into subtler things because it has to permeate. It has to permeate. So, everything, whatever it is, and the best of all is the air. That air becomes the vibration. So, you can see how the whatever has come out from this matter, from these five elements, becomes that subtle thing. Of course, the left side and right side both work it out, because the love has to work on this, and when love acts on matter, it becomes. And that is how one has to look at your own lives to make it a beautiful combination of love and matter. May God bless you.